Here's another look at a hierarchy of narrative, the structure that keeps chaos at bay. And this is maybe the hierarchy that I engage in when I'm writing, and I'm doing all these things at the same time. That's what's cool. You know, like when I ask a student, what are you doing when you write an essay? It's like, well, that's a hard question, right? It's like, well, you're fast and important question. That's the first thing you should do if you're writing an essay. Then you're paying attention to the words and the phrases and the sentences and the sentence relationship between the sentences within the paragraphs and the paragraph relationships to one another within the essay. And then the essay's relevance to the class and the class's relevance to your life. And like the essay bleeds out across your entire life. And so if I'm writing something, well, obviously at the most highest resolution level of analysis, I'm actually moving my fingers on the keyboard and moving my eyes back and forth on the screen. That's where the mind meets the body. But then I'm trying to formulate a sentence, and so I try to think up a good sentence that's nailing what I am trying to formulate, and then I try to pick it apart. And I do that a bunch of ways. I take the sentence and I put it on another page, and then I write like 10 different variants of the sentence and see if I can get a better variant. And then I try to think of ways that it's a stupid sentence to see if I can, you know, put a pry bar underneath it and loosen it up. And if I can't manage that, then I keep the sentence that I've got. And then I do that with 10 sentences in a paragraph, and I make sure the sentences are all arranged properly in the paragraph the same way by rewriting a bunch of different variants of it and trying to get the word right and the phrase right and the sentence right and the sentence order right and the paragraph order right. And I can tell when it's right enough because I can't make it any better. That doesn't mean it's right. It just means I can't improve it. And so I get to the point where if I'm writing a paragraph and I write a variant and I can't tell if the variant is any better and it might be worse, then I'm done. I've hit the limit of my intellectual capacity and it's time to move on. But you know, that it isn't like the essay that I'm writing, let's say, has a boundary that's tightly drawn around the essay, because there's a reason I'm writing the damn essay, and that would be, well, I'm trying to write a whole manuscript. Hopefully I'm trying to address an important problem, because why would I be doing it otherwise? I mean, that would be kind of pointless. And maybe that's part of my role as a scientist, and that's a subset of my role as a professor, and then that's a subset of my role as a productive citizen, and then that's a subset of my role of someone who confronts the unknown, you see? And that's why the logos is the thing that's at the top of the hierarchy. That's how the hierarchy should be structured, is that everything else should be, see, because you have a structure, and you think, well, what should the structure be subordinate to? And then the answer should be something like, the structure should be subordinate to the process that generates the structure, or the structure should be subordinate to the process that generates and maintains the structure. Well, obviously, how could it be any other way? Unless the structure's perfect, in which case you dispense with the thing that generates it and improves it, but then you're a totalitarian. It's like, hey, we got the answer. It's like, no, you don't. People are still suffering, and they're still dying. You don't have the damn answer. And so maybe you have an answer that means that there isn't quite as much suffering and dying as there could be, but there's plenty of road to be traveled yet. And so it makes perfect sense that all of this should be nested within this, I think of it sort of as the highest order of moral striving. And then that also gives you a moral hierarchy. That's the most important thing. You do that with honest speech. You do that with attention and honest speech. That's how you do that. And you don't sacrifice that to any of this, because if you do, then you're hurting your soul. There's this idea in the New Testament that the sin against the Holy Ghost is the one sin that can't be forgiven. No one knows what the hell that means. Maybe it doesn't mean anything. But I think this is what it means, is that because this process generates all this, if you violate that process, then there's no hope for you. Because that's the process by which you improve yourself and everyone else too, everything else. So if you decide you're not going to engage in that, it's like, well, there's no fixing that, because you've blown apart your relationship with the thing that does the fixing.